Welcome back, student. We have already studied about the monohybrid and dihybrid cross, and on the basis of these two cross, Gregor Johann Mendel put forward some laws or the principles. These principles and laws are called the law of inheritance or the principle of inheritance. Today we are going to cover that part only. Okay, so this is the part number 7 of lesson 5, the principle of inheritance. In this part we are going to study about the principle or law of inheritance. So on the basis of observation of monohybrid and dihybrid cross, Mendel has given some laws, and there are mainly 3 important laws. The first law that has been given by Mendel was the law of dominance, although this should be come in second point, because during the course of crossing, when a simple trait is crossed with another trait, first of all they forms the gamete, and in the formation of gamete each trait is get separated or segregated. So the first law should be law of segregation, and after that when they combine, then comes the law of dominance. But although in many books the law of dominance has been given in starting as a point number 1, that's why we are explaining this topic. So what is law of dominance? During the course of monohybrid cross, when a plant is crossed, when two pure line plant are crossed together, these are the two pure line plants. It is a pure tall, it is a pure drop. The gamete forms between them is capital T, capital T, and between this is small t, small t. When they both combine, they give capital T, small t, and another will also give the capital T, small t. So it is F1 generation. In this generation, Gregor Johann Mendel observed that while he crossed the two different plant having two different traits of same character, that is tallness and dropness, he got only tallness in the F1 generation. And he thought where the dropness has been hidden. Means the dropness is become hide in this case, that is in F1 generation. So on the basis of this cross, he gave a very simple and first law of inheritance, that is law of dominance. Means out of two traits, if present together, this is the two traits. Out of two traits, if present together, one is able to express and another remains suppressed. Which one is expressed? Capital T expressed. And which one is suppressed? Small t, that is dropness suppressed. So out of two contrasting character or two contrasting traits present together, you can see the two contrasting traits present together. One is able to express, one means tallness has expressed, and another remains suppressed, means dropness suppressed. The one which express is called dominant character, and the one which remains suppressed is called recessive character. So in F1 generation, he got that dominant character is expressed, but recessive character has been suppressed. While when he allowed the self-pollination of the progeny of F1 generation, he got back the recessive character in F2 generation. Because you know the offspring produced in F2 generation is capital T, capital T, two capital T small t and one small t small t. So he got back the recessive character. By this he got or he understood that recessive character can only be expressed when they are present in pair. Means if two genes of the recessive character present together, then it will be expressed. Understood? So either capital T or capital T, if both the dominant, then it will be pure line. If one of them is dominant and another is recessive, then it will be hybrid, but both of them will show the dominant character. Understood? Let's study the definition. Out of a pair of contrasting character, or you can say traits, present together, this is the character or trait, both of them are present together, one is able to express. One means tallness is expressing, while other remains suppressed. Which one is suppressed? Yes, dwarfness. Yes, dwarfness remains suppressed. The one which expresses is called dominant character. So which one is expressed? Tallness. So tallness will be called dominant character, and one which remains suppressed is called recessive character. And which one remains suppressed? Dwarfness. So dwarfness will be called recessive character. Understood? Next, the recessive character can express only when it present in a pair. The recessive character can express only when the pair consists of both recessive trait. Means if there is a two recessive trait or a pair of recessive trait, then can it be able to express itself. But it cannot be able to express in presence of a dominant trait. In this case, the recessive trait cannot be able to express itself in presence of any dominant character. Understood? Next, a character that are controlled by discrete unit is called factor. Again, he is putting forward some more points which you already know, because I have already explained so many times. So he told the character are controlled by some factor, and this factor is obviously genes, but this factor always occur in pair. Like this is the two factor and this is the pair of the factor. So the factor or the gene always present in pair or in form of allele. The dissimilar pair of factor are factor one member of pair will be dominant and other will be recessive. Means if it is dissimilar, suppose this is the dissimilar, one will be the dominant and another will be recessive. We have not written recessive, you should write it. It is a printing mistake over here. Recessive. So if there is a dissimilar pair of factor, one will be dominant and another will be recessive. Now a very important question is arising. What is the question? Let's see. Why do the dominant gene express? Why the capital only express? Why does or why can the small t cannot able to express? And why the small t express only in pair? These two questions is there. First, I am giving the answer of first question. Why does the dominant gene express itself? Dominant gene expresses itself because it has a complete functional enzyme that perfectly expresses it. Means, I think you know that. If you do not know, try to understand what I am telling you. Every gene has some peculiar characteristics. Suppose there is a capital T and capital T. These two capital T, this gene is making its own protein and this gene also making its own protein. If both the protein are same, the character will be dominant. If this is the dissimilar, this capital T is making its own protein, this small t is making its own protein, but the capital T is dominant, So it will produce a protein which is very functional and which will perfectly act on a particular kind of function. While this protein, the protein that is produced by the recessive trait, will not produce a protein that is much functional that is required. Means the protein produced is defective type, and this protein cannot able to express itself. So the protein produced by dominant is much more important than recessive one. That is written over here. So why does the dominant gene express itself? Because it produced a functional protein, that is functional enzyme. Enzyme is nothing but a protein that perfectly express it, means that does the work. And due to that function, due to doing that function, it able to express itself. Understood? Let's have another question. Why does recessive gene not able to express itself when it present in a dominant gene, with a dominant gene? Suppose this is the recessive gene. Why does recessive gene does not able to express itself when present with dominant gene? Let's see the answer of this question. This is because it form an incomplete and defective enzyme which failed to express itself. Understood? That is the thing. The capital T produce a perfect and healthy enzyme, and this enzyme can able to express itself by doing a particular kind of function. While the small t means recessive forms a incomplete and defective type of enzyme, and this enzyme can't be able to express itself. That's why they can't show a particular kind of character while present in the dominant, because dominant has made its own and this expressing the character, but this is defective. This cannot be able to show any particular kind of character. That's why the capital T remain dominant and showing its own character, while small t remain present over there but can't be able to express itself. I think you're understanding. Next. Yes. It can express, yeah, the double small t or the pair of double small t can express itself when present in pair by forming that particular kind of protein. And that particular kind of protein over if present together express some another character which will be the recessive character. So it is the end of our first law, that is law of dominance. Let's have a see about the second law, that is law of segregation. What is law of segregation? Just see, I have already make you understand that when you are going to cross between two traits of a character, suppose capital T and small t, what do you do first? First of all, you segregate the two allele. These are the capital T and the two different allele. You segregate the two allele in two different gametes. So desegregate means separate. You separate this in two different gametes. Here, this capital T is not blending with this capital T, or not mixing with this capital T. Means there is no any kind of mixing of gamete can be seen, or no any kind of mixing of character can be seen. Means each character separate without any mixing. So this is called law of segregation. So I have shown you that capital T and small t are get separated over here. What will happen when capital T and small t both make their own gamete? In one gamete, only this capital will go, capital T will go, and in another gamete, only this small t will go. So you can see the capital T is purely present in one gamete, and the small t is purely present in another gamete. There is no any blending or mixing of any kind of character or trait in any of the gamete. So it is also called the law of purity of gamete. Means gametes are pure with respect to each and every trait or character. I think you understood. Let me see the definition. This law is also called the law of purity of gamete. As I already told you, the two pair of a factor, two pair means capital T or small t. Suppose this is another pair. The two pair of a factor separate during the formation of gamete. Get separated, yes, during the formation of gamete. And they do not blend but segregate or separate into different gamete. They do not blend, means they do not mix. They get separate fully into two different gamete. Thus, during gamete formation, what we have learned? Homozygous produce similar gamete. Homozygous means capital capital or small small, produce similar gamete. See, capital T, same gamete. Small t, same gamete. So, what will happen in heterozygous condition? The heterozygous produce different kinds of gametes with different traits, because heterozygous contain two different traits. So, it will produce two different gametes. Although, this gamete will not mix at all. So, I think you understood the law of segregation. Let's have the third law, that is law of independent assortment. Although the first two law was be discovered by the monohybrid cross by Mendel, while the third law has been discovered by dihybrid cross. Although you have learned by dihybrid cross, you can easily understand this law. Let's study law of independent assortment. What happened in dihybrid cross? Try to understand. In case of dihybrid cross, Mendel has taken two characters at the same time. Capital R, capital R, capital Y, capital R, and small r, small y. It was round and yellow seed, and it was wrinkle and green seed. But when he crossed the round yellow seed with wrinkle green seed in F2 generation, he got two new kind of phenotypic character, that is round and green and wrinkle and yellow. He thought he has not given any kind of such character to be crossed. Then how did he get, or how did he get that particular kind of character? Means how the new character has been arisen become a very important point to be thought by Mendel. Means Mendel start thinking, why did he get two new kind of character? Let's have see the definition. When there is two pair of contrasting character, that is round and yellow and wrinkle and green, distributed to the member of one pair with the gamete is independent to the distribution of other pair, as is seen in the production of gamete in F1 hybrid of dihybrid cross. So what happened during dihybrid cross? In course of dihybrid cross, during F2 generation, the F1 progeny produced four kind of gametes, that is capital R, capital Y, capital R, small y, small r capital Y and small r small y. When he make the Punnett square on the basis of these four kind of gamete, he got two new character, isn't it? So in a dihybrid cross, two new combination has been observed by him, that is round green and wrinkle yellow are formed, which are new combination of the trait. So he thought, why it is called so? It is due to independent assortment, means the capital R capital Y, capital R small y, small r capital Y, and small r small y of one progeny will combine with capital R capital Y or capital R small y or small r capital Y or small r small y. Which one of this capital R small y will combine with either of these is totally independent, means this capital R capital Y have four options to combine. It can combine with this one or this one or this one or this one. Similarly, it has also have four options. So which kind of gamete will combine with which kind of gamete of another pair is just independent, means it is depend on nature, means naturally it can combine with any one of them. So the assortment means combination, this capital R small capital R small, this capital R capital Y will combine with which one of the four, 1, 2, 3, 4, is totally dependent on nature. It do not go according to some perfect formula or perfect rule. It is independently, so the assortment is independent to independent and depends on nature. So this is called independent law of independent assortment. Just see the definition. I think you understood. When there is a two pair of contrasting character, the distribution of member of one pair, suppose there are distribution of member of one pair, how many gamete were there? Four gamete were there, no? So distribution of one member of one pair into the gamete is independent to the distribution of other. Which one will we go to which kind of gamete or combine is totally independent. Understood? As seen in production of F1 units. In dihybrid cross, due to this random combination or combining of the gametes, two new kind of offspring are produced. Which one is not present at all? What were these? They were round and green. Round green is not present earlier when they parents are combined, and wrinkle yellow. It is due to independent assortment of trait for seed shape, that is round, wrinkle, or seed color, that is round and green. So the new combination form, these are the parental form combination. 9 is a parental combination because round, this 9 is round and yellow. So 9 is parental combination. 1 is also parental combination because wrinkle and green. This round and yellow and wrinkle and green has been taken for the crossing. But these two are new combination. That is 3 wrinkled and yellow and 3 round and green. And this is caused, this new character has been developed due to independent assortment of the gametes between the to F1 progeny. I think you understood. So here we are ending this lesson or study. We will study the next topic in our next class. If you have any problem, you must ask me. Otherwise, make the notes and send it. Okay? Bye-bye.